obsessed with musicals, and I was so excited when I found out we were doing a musical.
I thought it was genius and it was wildly ambitious.
Stop. The writing staff, a lot of the guys consider ourselves ESPN jock types, but we found out early on there's a closet love of musical theater.
You got dreams? You want fame? Well, fame costs. And right here is where you start paying in sweat.
You think, I can't do it, I can't possibly do it.
I screwed up. Well, put your mind.
And then you look at it and it's done and you realize, well, I didn't do it. Looks like I did it, so, okay.
You belong at Sacred. Doctors, nurses, patients, dead guys. Welcome to Sacred.
Are you okay, ma'am?
How many fingers do you see?
Call 911 emergency.
The great thing about Bill Lawrence is that he grew up going to Broadway. He's always wanted to do the musical. So it was really just finding the right idea. And once I had that, you know, he was gangbusters. He's like, yeah, let's do this.
Because the cast were all musical theater fans as well, we all said that before we ended the series, we would do one.
A fabulous Tony nominated Stephanie DiPruzzo. And she's playing the patient, Patty Miller.
Shut your Where to God, I'll shut it soon.
And the whole episode is basically sort of through her eyes, because she's the one coming in saying she's hearing music, and because she's hearing it, we get to hear it.
One more thing that I should mention, if what I've heard is true, and everyone appears to be singing to you.
Wherever I am, everybody is surrounding me. On that gurney, that's the best shot.
To get to do a musical, of course, I wanted Broadway people.
And Zach was the one who said the immortal words, hey, we should get those guys from Avenue Q.
I wrote Avenue Q, which is a Tony-winning Broadway musical. And I got an email from Randall, the producer, that said, I'm the producer of a show called SCRUBS. And, you know, we're doing a musical episode, and we'd like you to be part of it. Have you ever heard of it? And, you know, would you be interested? And I was like, would we be interested? Yeah.
Those guys really... brought it to a new level. Instead of just something that we were goofing around with, it became an actual musical written by people who had successfully done it and won Tonys before.
Deb Fordham drafted all the lyrics and gave us a script with her mock lyrics. And usually songwriters hate getting mock lyrics, but you know, especially as nobody could possibly be more familiar with the show, the characters, the situations, the episode, what needs to happen.
You're the only man who's ever been inside of me.
Whoa, I just took out his appendix.
We also worked with a fabulous composer, Paul Perry.
Randall, the producer, asked me if I was interested in writing songs for the musical episode they were doing. And I said, yes, I would.
It's guy love between two guys.
Everybody liked the way guy love came out. When I wrote it, I was really thinking more of a power ballad. And they said, that's great, let's do it like Endless Love.
It's guy love between two guys.
Oh, I got afraid of using bravado.
Bill Lawrence knows that I've got this musical theater background, and he's a huge musical theater nerd himself.
This man knows more about musical theater than almost. I could name a musical, and you could do a song.
I did not say it was cool. I did not say it was cool to say that. I happen to. I'm not embarrassed. I'll say it in public. I like musical theater. I'm okay with it.
And said, how would you like to do this? And I said, absolutely. And then Deb sent me this script, which is just so adorable. And then get the Avenue Q guys, and I go, God, I got
to
do that.
Our baby made the choice to be at home and not at work. So let us all rejoice, because she's a brand new mama to her.
A guy named Roger Love came in and voice coached each of the actors, spent time with them.
I love musicals, so I jumped at the chance of doing it. It sounded like a lot of fun.
Roger's an extraordinary coach because he has the ability to take people who really aren't singers, and none of us are really singers, but he can make you believe for a little while that maybe you are.
Knowing the show, I felt that anything was possible with the lyrics, so nothing was going to shock me. I was extremely touched by It All Comes Down to Poo.
Everything comes down to poo.
Whether it's a tumor or a touch of the flu, please won't you pinch us off a big fat clue?
Our number one test is your number two.
Zach was completely open, you know, he came in, he listened to my ideas, we worked on his voice. He loves musicals.
All across the nation, we trust in defecation.
So he's got a really good ear and can sing, and we had a lot of fun.
Friends forever!
That's it.
He was tip-top to work with.
We're as close as
the vena cava and the aorta.
The vena cava and the aorta. The vena cava and the aorta.
Donald has a musical background.
Manly way, but in a totally manly way.
I want that grit in me.
Okay. But in a totally manly way. Let's go!
He's the one that's the most apt for kind of sounding like a recording artist.
I'll be there to share the high.
Feels very professional already with these things on.
They told us that she was the sweetest person in the world, and they were absolutely right.
Here at Sacred Heart.
That's a long one.
So most singers are like, oh, if I do it again, I'm going to throw something through the window. She's like, can I do it 500 times again and be happy about the 500th time?
A hypodermic needle and a latex tourniquet.
Diverticulitis and a barium enema.
I'm up to feeling a chylomelic acid.
Love her.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kelso.
Oh, I'm delighted that you came.
Ken, I saw him on Broadway in Big River when I was 14.
Welcome to Sacred Heart.
He is such a pro. We gave him all the hard parts.
As soon as I heard Ken, I was like, this is the real deal.
Oh, God, that was so funny.
He already had the voice, so it was just tailoring that into what we needed here. But, you know, he's the real deal.
It's your hair, your nose, your chin, little face. You always need a hug.
The patter song that they have me doing is remarkably challenging.
That you think I am your mentor just continues to perplex. And oh my God, stop telling me when you have nerdy sex.
We found with some of Cox's stuff, there was some value in singing kind of almost a Rex Harrison talk sometimes, because he does talk so quickly. And it does support the character as well.
It makes me suicidal, and I'm not the only one. No, I'm not the only one.
Neil is a fantastic singer.
I'm just short of great. I can carry a tune.
He was probably one of the best at singing and acting in the particular character, which is always hard. Just because you're a great actor doesn't mean that you sing like you're a great actor. So Neil was like singing and acting right at the same time and was, you know, dead on the money.
As long as you avoid the bathrooms on the second floor.
Not being a trained singer, we prefer that because, you know, it gives you character.
I think the first thing you're going to notice is, God, those guys can sing.
It's all about communicating a joke or an idea or sympathy, but the lyrics are conversational.
I say sí, which is yes in Dominican.
The vocal performances from every cast member were just great.
We had a week of rehearsal with Lance and his assistant, Lisa.
The choreographer who put the dances together for the musical was Lance McDonald. We used him before in
the West Side Story one.
He's helped us out quite a few times.
We do shockingly more singing and dancing than most half-hour sitcoms. It's very odd. I don't know how that happened.
Could they be out and then all of a sudden, bam, there's five other heads that pop?
Love it. We have 9 core dancers plus the cast, and then I got to work with this particular group, the 50 dancers, for one day. What gives me the most joy is bringing out the story. And so when I get an opportunity to work with actors like Zach and Donald and Sarah, who are so committed to the material that I'm giving, where I'm committed to their character, it's just kind of fun to bring the two together.
One of the most amazing things about the show was after we wrote the songs is to have a full orchestra come in and record the music for them. I mean, that just doesn't happen in episodic television. It was some of the LA Philharmonic's best players.
I think the musicians really do enjoy working on a project like this, particularly hearing these words for the first time. It was definitely fun to see their reactions.
It was so satisfying as writers, too, that to see these professional musicians, they didn't know what these songs were, and then they were playing them and looking at the lyrics, and the best thing was they would slowly start to laugh and crack up, and it was total validation for us.
I love the lyrics for this episode, and in particular, I think Pooh is just going to become a musical theater classic. At least I hope it does.
Yeah,
thank you.
Doug's happy, we're happy.
The meat of it is seeing the cast of Scrubs sing and dance.
I love watching musicals just because, I mean, you can't not smile when you're watching one.
It's great fun. It's just a roller coaster ride.
And it's exciting to be in the studio working with great people who are just all there, excited to be doing something new, excited to be out of their element when they don't usually sing and do musicals. It's great that everybody seems to enjoy what we did.
Your world's become a musical, and your doctors speak in rhymes.
It was really cool, and it invigorated us and made us excited to be back at work.
I'll always be there for you.
It was truly one of the highlights of my television career. That's a good end.
That is. And wrap.
I landed the role of Carla by auditioning, just like everybody else. I auditioned on tape at the NBC in New York City. As wonderful as I knew this pilot was, I had no idea. So every time it got picked up for the back nine or for the rest of the season, we were just completely beside ourselves. So just to be here at this point, it's been wonderfully surreal. My sister's a licensed nurse practitioner. And I still have to call her when I have questions about anything medical. She actually told me when she first saw the pilot, she says, "You stole my character, you bitch." Because our job is to be funny and make everybody laugh, and it's an ensemble show, and it's not on any one person's shoulder, I think it's a little more balanced and a lot more fun. We go to work to make people laugh and touch their hearts. Carla has evolved from being a sassy no-nonsense Carla Espinosa to being a sassy no-nonsense Carla Espinosa hyphen Turk. She's married and gone through the trials and tribulations of being a very hard-working, skilled nurse at the hospital and mother, and this season in particular, dealing with postpartum depression. Carla and Turk are meant to be together, and they set the tone and the example for everybody else on the show. And I think in the end, people want to live up to what Carla and Turk stand for. I think, you know, she keeps him in line, he keeps her a little light. You know, where she's so serious, he gets her to laugh, and where he's so immature, she gets him to grow up. You know what I mean? I think the baby, Izzy, has provided a lot of balance. She actually made a decision to stay home, which Turk pretended to leave up to her, but he was actually thrilled about, because he was such a mama's boy growing up. So, but it turned out Carla was actually really super torn, because she loves being a nurse more than anything. Carla being the type of character who, being a nurse and working in the hospital, having the experience over the other interns, and is just a know-it-all busybody type, wasn't expecting to go through what she went through during the whole postpartum depression. So she was kind of running around like she can totally handle it because of who she is, because she's the strongest couple. These particular episodes I got in advance, so it just gave me an opportunity to just kind of reach inside and deal with my own personal dramas and bring those up. And that's kind of like the cool thing about Scrubs, that as much of a comedy as it is, and this season in particular, Bill Lawrence and the writers never shy away from the dramatic elements. Bill put it really well. He goes, so basically what's gonna happen is Carla's pregnant and you're gonna go from like 3 months to like 7 months in within two episodes. And depending on how much we had to see, you know, there would be very heavy prosthetics. I like the ones with the big plastic boobs. It always made me feel endowed. The musical episode was one of the highlights for me. It was such a wild, wonderful experience. Just before we were going to go into rehearsal for that episode, I took a bad fall in the shower of my house and I fractured my pelvis. And I remember when I went into the hospital, the first thing Sarah Chalk and I got to speak when I was in the hospital about to go into surgery, and she was like, "Oh my God, Judy, are you okay?" And I was like, "My tango! They're gonna dig my tango!" The entire, you know, musical was just kind of like rearranged, restructured so that I could participate, and then we shot the tango once I recovered and added it in later. It made it regardless. I know that Bill and the writers had been discussing for all along, it's like, look, it's been six seasons and there's no way that we're gonna be working in a hospital, and as much as we are a comedy talking about death and losing patients left and right, and not dealing with the death of one of our own. So we get the script and we read, oh snap, you know, it's gonna be Laverne dies. So we're like crushed. You know, how do we deal with that? It was exquisitely written, the speech. So much so that all I had to do was look at it and my eyes would water. But then it's the reality of it. So he goes, so, yes, I remember him saying, so the bad news is Laverne dies. But the good news is she's gonna come back as like her twin sister or something. As much of a comedy as it is, you know, you're working in a hospital and you have to deal with things like, you know, the heaviness of illness and death. But you know that without joy, you can't have sadness, and without laughter, you can't have tears, and vice versa. When Zach and Donald are in a scene together, I mean, the crew's cracking up. Even Bill comes down and he's like, all right, guys, let's get going. But we're laughing our asses off all day. Throw Sarah in the mix. I was like, these two are gonna try to make Sarah laugh in the middle of her close-up. And if Johnny C's got big speeches and the medical jargon, you know that the medical jargon's gonna be like cracking up. And if I'm gonna be doing the scene, you know that I'm gonna be ultra serious about it. You know, I mean, we know Ken Jenkins is gonna be doing his scene. You know, you're gonna laugh your ass off on Ken Jenkins. And if you know Neil Flynn's got his scene, you know he's gonna be doing his improvs and he's gonna be doing something predictably hilarious. And if, you know, Sam Lloyd's gonna be doing his scenes, you know something's gonna, genius is gonna be coming out of there. And if there's anything in question, Bill Lawrence is going to be there to watch the scene run through. You know, that's the beauty of working on Scrubs. I don't know, Bill, am I the head nurse now? Watch this, let me know.